Welcome Kingdom Fellowship. It's another worship experience. We're so excited to worship the Lord today, and we welcome you to this worship experience. And our prayer today is that you be strengthened as we worship the Lord. Hallelujah. As we celebrate this Mother's Day, hallelujah, we give praise. Come on, clap your hands right there where you are for every mother, hallelujah, who has sacrificed their time, hallelujah. And we thank you, God, as we pray today, Lord, that you'll be in the middle of our worship experience. We thank you so much for being so good. We thank you, Lord, for changing our lives from the inside out. Lord, we're changed forevermore because of you. And we stand on your word that says that we can do exceedingly, abundantly, above all we ask or think. It's by the power, your strength that works in us. Thank you, Lord Jesus, in good times, in times of lack, in times of wealth, and in times of plenty. Lord, we can still do all things through you that strengthen us. Give us your strength as we pray, as we worship, as we dive into your word. Have your perfect will and your ways. Our prayer in Jesus' name. Somebody say in Jesus' name. Amen. Oh, God is able to do just what he said he would do. He's gonna fulfill every promise to you. Oh, so don't give up on God, 'cause he won't give up on you. He's able. Come on, clap those hands right there where you are. Let's lift up Jesus together and say he's able.
He's able.
Yes, he is. Oh. Come on, everybody, let's lift it together. God is able to do just what he
says
he would. And he's going to fulfill, yes, every promise. He'll fulfill it to you. Don't give up on God, because he won't give up. He's able. Come on, clap those hands if you believe it. I want you to lift it to the heavens. He's able.
He's able.
Oh, oh, oh. Yes, he is. Come on, lift it and say, God is able to do.
God is able to
just what he said.
Just what he said.
He would do. He's gonna fulfill every promise. Yourself and say he's able.
He's able.
Oh, 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 oh. Hallelujah. Lift that war cry. We say, oh, 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 oh. He's able. You say,
oh, he's able.
Let me hear you say, oh.
Yeah.
Say, oh, 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 He's gonna do it. We believe He's promised. He's able. Come on, He's able. Yes, He is. Yes, He is. He's able.
Jesus, let us go before the Lord in prayer as every head is bowed, every eye is closed, every heart is open, and every spirit is praying. Eternal God, our Father, we thank You for another opportunity to gather in Your name. We understand that where two or three are gathered, You are in our midst. And so we thank You, God, that You transcend space, You transcend time, that You are right with us where we are. And so, God, we thank You for another gathering that we can call upon Your name and to tell You just how much we love You, to just love on You and tell You that we adore You, just to tell You, God, that there is none like You. And so, God, as we assembled in our various places, we call on You as Lord of all. And God, if we never needed You before, we certainly need You now. And we call upon You for strength and for courage, for strength in these days, God, where we find ourselves weak, where we find ourselves worn, where we find ourselves, God, discouraged by the things that we see. Help us, God, not to focus on that which we see, but to focus on that which we know, and that You are a God who sees and who knows and who comes down to see about us, God. In this evil and vile world, God, when we think we've seen the worst, God, we see things that God get even worse, God. And we pray, God, that even though evil seems to take its place in this world, that we know that there's still goodness in this world and that there's more goodness in us than there is evil in this world. And so, God, help us to shine the light of Jesus wherever we are. Help us to shine the light of Jesus, God, in our homes, in the various places where we can have influence. God, let somebody know that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. We ask now, God, that you would be with those families who are impacted by the tragedies of this world, by the injustices, God, by the racism, by the evil that goes on in this world, God. We call upon you, God, as a just God who knows and who gives us truth to power to speak up and out against that which is evil and which is against your word. God, we pray for this nation and this pandemic, God. We lift up our hands in praise and worship, God. We lift up our hands as a sign of surrender, God, acknowledging that we don't have the answers, but you are the answer, God. In you is all truth and all knowledge and all power. So we surrender ourselves unto you and under your authority and under your power. Have your way in our life. In our lives, God, we ask, God, that you would move by your spirit, which you would lift up the bowed down head, the broken hearted, God, that you would mend, God, relationships. God, we thank you for the gift of motherhood. We acknowledge that there are some who may be grieving. There are some who may be having a difficulty. There are some who have challenging situations, but we thank you that you are a mother to the motherless, that you are everything that we need. And God, we give you glory and we give you honor for the relationships that we have, and we endeavor to honor you, God, in everything that we do. So God, get the glory out of our lives. Get the glory out of this day. Get the glory out of this moment. God, have your way in this place. Heal our land, God, is our continuous prayer. Send your balm in this place, God. Let it permeate, God, like never before. Have your way, God. Let this world see your glory. Let this world see your light like never before. Have your way in this time of word and worship. Bless us, God, collectively together as we say amen, thank God, and bless your name. Hallelujah. We thank and praise God for another opportunity to be in his midst. How many of you grateful to share in this place, in this time, in this space with God? It's sacred time, it's sacred space, and we are grateful another day that God has spared us. And so we look forward to his word as the word comes today from the Gospel of John, the Gospel of John in the first chapter, the Gospel of John chapter 14, reading verses 1 through 14. That's good too. John chapter 14, verses 1 through 14. In the New International Version, these words are recorded. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house have many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you may also be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way? Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really knew me, if you really know me, you will know my Father as well. From now on, you do not know him and have seen him. Philip said, Lord, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us. Jesus answered, don't you know me, Philip? Even after I have been among you such a long time, anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Don't you believe that I am the Father and that the Father is in me? The words I say to you, I do not speak on my own authority. Rather, it is the Father living in me who is doing his work. Believe me when I say that I am the Father and the Father is in me, or at least believe on the evidence of the works themselves. Very truly, I tell you, whoever believes in me will do the works I have been doing, and they will do even greater things than these, because I am going to the Father. And I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. You may ask me for anything in my name, and I will do it. Amen, amen. That is good news. We are grateful that we can go to our Father and ask anything in His name, and that He will provide that for us according to His will and His purpose for us. Amen. The purpose for us gathering today is to be in the presence of the Lord, to worship Him in spirit and in truth. God has gifted us with another opportunity to again worship and praise Him, and so we ought to do just that. We greet you once again. This is Kingdom Fellowship. We are just happy in Jesus, and we are not ashamed to show it wherever we are. We tell the world that we are what? Kingdom focused. And so we are doing just that in all of the ministries and the things that we have, doing the work of the Lord here at Kingdom Fellowship. And so perhaps this is your first opportunity worshiping with us online. We want to take time to recognize you. We want to take time to greet you in our own special way. Our online host will guide you to where it is. You can fill out some information so that we can stay connected with you. And we also invite you to our chat room. We have a wonderful chat room. We praise and we worship in our own way with our emojis, all the various things that we can show our enthusiasm and our excitement to the Lord. And so we want to give you a Holy Ghost shout out. Perhaps you're from the West Coast. Perhaps you're from down south, up north, or you're here in the DMV area. We have persons internationally joining with us as well. Come on and join us in the chat room and tell us where you're from so that we can give you a Holy Ghost shout out. Now we want to welcome you in our own special way. We have our theme song that we sing every time we get an opportunity to sing it. Come on and sing it along with us. Gather, grow, give, go.
Gather, grow, give, go.
Gather, grow, give, go.
Gather, grow, give, go.
Gather, grow, give, go. We are Kingdom Fellowship. We're kingdom focused.
Gather, grow, give, go.
Gather, grow, give, go.
We are Kingdom.
We are Kingdom Fellowship. We're kingdom focused. We gather to worship the Lord. So glad you chose to join us. Let's grow in the Word together. Give our heart to Jesus.
Gather, grow, give, go.
Gather, grow, give, go.
Gather, grow, give, go.
Gather, grow, give, go. We are Kingdom Fellowship. We're kingdom focused. We gather to worship the Lord. So glad you chose to join us. Let's grow.
Kingdom Focus. Praise the Lord. I'm so glad to see you on this day, and I'm especially excited to say Happy Mother's Day to every natural mother, to every godmother, to every surrogate mother. grandmother. We just want to thank you for the ministry of motherhood, because we recognize that what you have done for us has been certainly a ministry, and we've been the beneficiaries for it. We certainly wish that we could be here in person to greet you and to celebrate with you. On behalf of all of the family, we want to say we love you, and certainly we're going to go pick some dandelions since we can't get to the florist just to present you with something to let you know how much we appreciate you. In fact, I'm going to pause right now because we prepared a little Mother's Day welcome for you right now.
Happy Mother's Day, Mommy. Love you so much.
Happy Mother's Day. I love you, Mom.
You taught me everything and everything you've given me.
Happy Mother's Day, Grandma. We love you.
Mother's Day,
Mommy,
we love you, we miss you and we love you.
And it just wouldn't feel right if I didn't have you by my side. Oh, you were there for me to love and care for me when skies were gray. Whenever I was down, you were always there to comfort me. No one else can be what you have been to me. You will always be, you will always be the girl in my life for all time.
Mama, Mama, you know I love you.
Happy Mother's Day. Thank you for all the kind things and wonderful stuff you've done for me, like the hash browns, holding my clothes occasionally, and every other good stuff. I hope you have a great day. I love you.
My tears from the stars. Yes, it's it. Mama, I just want you to know. Loving you is like food to my soul.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is.
Happy Mother's Day, Kingdom Fellowship, Mom. And Mom, we love you.
I want to wish Donna Allen a very happy Mother's Day.
Happy Mother's Day, Mom.
Happy Mother's Day, Mom.
Happy Mother's Day, Mom.
Love you.
Love you.
Thank God for you.
And you took up for me when everyone was down on me. You always did understand. You gave me strength to go on. Times looking back when I was so afraid, and then you come to me and say to me, I could face anything, and no one else can do what you've done for me. You'll always be, you will always be the girl in my life. Ooh, oh.
Mama, Mama.
Happy Mother's Day, Mom. I love you so much.
Happy Mother's Day, Mom. Love you.
Happy Mother's Day, Mom. We love you. Cooper loves you, too.
Happy Mother's Day, Mom. I love you.
Happy Mother's Day.
Mama, you're the queen of my heart. The queen of my heart.
Your love is like tears from the stars.
Your love is like tears from the stars.
Mama.
Well, praise the Lord. We're certainly grateful to God to celebrate this Mother's Day. And this certainly also is the season where we celebrate all of our college graduates. I want to salute and to celebrate every individual who has completed your requirements and have been able to receive your diploma. I know it hurts not to be able to physically walk across the stage, but I'm going to tell you something that my grandfather told my father and my father told me, that once you have education, it's something that no one can ever take away. And so I just want to say how proud I am of you as your pastor, that you have persevered. I know that there have been any number of academic and life challenges that you have faced over these last years, and you have overcome. And I believe that God has greater in store. And even though this current moment is bittersweet, I believe that even this will help to prepare you for life and for life's journey. And so we're just excited to thank all those who helped you to get to where you are, your parents and godparents and sponsors and others who just spurred you along the way. Even as you're taking this moment, please make sure that you take some time to figure out a way to tell them thank you, because Lord knows you wouldn't have made it without them and you would not have made it without him. So to God be the glory for great things he has done in your life. And we're looking forward to figuring out how we can celebrate more with you later on in this season. I do want to remind all of us that we're in a new month, and so there are a number of ministry opportunities that we are providing. Just because we're not able to meet physically does not stop us from doing the work of the kingdom and the ministry. And so please go onto our website, kingdom.global, and there you'll find our Gather God with a number of resources to help you to grow spiritually during this season. Particularly, we're excited for our young people and how they continue to develop their skills and to grow in grace and to allow God to use their gifts in ministry. And so we're excited about all that's happening. We want to thank God for all those who are serving in youth ministry, Reverend Renee Jones and Reverend Mimi and all those, Brother Michael, everybody who's helping to pour into our children during this very pivotal season. And we look forward to seeing the fruit of your labor develop in their lives in the days to come. Listen, it's time to receive our tithes and offerings for today, and I'm certainly grateful to God that we have it to give. I just want to again thank you for your continued faithful support of this ministry, and because of your faithfulness in giving, we're now able to pivot as a ministry. As I indicated, because we're now in this different season, I have taken the responsibility of reprioritizing our budget as a church. And so we're focusing on three areas: missions, our overseas ministry, particularly with our partnership with Zion Church in Worcester, in the Republic of South Africa, right outside of Cape Town. That community was food insecure before COVID, and we know that South Africa had to induct very draconian measures because they didn't have the same kind of healthcare system to respond. And so we know that that need has only gotten even greater. And so we've already sold into that ministry. We're going to do so again this month. And I thank you for your support. We're giving in missions overseas, but we're also doing great outreach. In fact, we've expanded the reach of our outreach. One more time, big shout out to Reverend Kendra Smith, her entire team, who has been serving faithfully every week since we have been in this position. They've literally been on the front lines, and because we have not had resources sufficient in the past, we've increased those resources. So we went from 500 meals, 500 boxes of groceries. Now we're up to 750 boxes of groceries. That's literally directly because of your faithfulness and sowing into the work that we're doing here. If you desire to give specifically to our outreach ministry, literally everything that we gave last week, we spent. We've had to increase our capacity. We now are renting a refrigerator truck, and it's now become a major operation. And so I want to thank God for the logistical whiz of our leaders who are now able to actually provide. We're looking at providing support in multiple sites because we recognize that the need is so great, and every week this goes on, that need will continue. And so we're now organizing ourselves to provide foodstuffs in multiple sites. And again, all that you give goes directly to support that as relates to our Kingdom Cares ministry. If you'd like to sow or to be a support of our Kingdom Cares ministry, you can simply go to one of our electronic means of giving through our website or through the app and just look for the line that says Kingdom Care. All that you give on that line goes directly to support this work. As we continue to support others, we also continue to support the vital work of ministry that's going on here at Kingdom Fellowship. And so I want to thank you for your tithes and offerings. You know, for several weeks I failed to do this, and I wanted to apologize to you because it's my responsibility to always offer the opportunity for new tithers to join us in the tithing ministry. If you are new to Kingdom Fellowship, you've recently joined, or you're one of our partners, or you've been viewing online, and you recognize that tithing is the central premise of giving as relates to the kingdom of God, I want to encourage you to become a tither today. You can simply indicate that on the website right now or through the stream. And we certainly thank you because it is through our tithes principally that we're able to do all the work of ministry that God has called us to in addition to our offerings. And so again, if you want to join us in the tithing ministry here at Kingdom Fellowship, I certainly as pastor want to say thank you for that. And I want to thank again all those who are continuing to be faithful in paying your tithe and sowing your offering. Finally, we had a number of meetings this week with our stewardship and finance committee, our Kingdom Builders Committee, our trustees, as well as our entire leadership team to give them a substantive update as to where we stand on our Kingdom Builders campaign. As you know, God has called us to continue to move forward in building our new church in the midst even of what's going on right now. And I'm grateful that while we've had some challenges, we are in the midst of contingency planning and things are looking good and we're moving forward. So for those of you who are giving in our Kingdom Builders campaign, I want to say thank you. Literally what you're doing is making a difference. It lets us know that you are committed to this cause. And because of that, we can move forward with great expectation that God is going to continue to bless us. And so I want to thank you again. For those of you who may not be familiar, you can go to a tab on our website called Kingdom Builders to find out more information. We'll actually be enhancing that and building that out in the coming weeks to come. The third priority in the budget that I made after missions and outreach was to expand our online and digital capacity. We're actually believing that this is an opportunity that during this season of crisis, we have the opportunity to actually reach more souls for the kingdom of God and for the cause of Christ. Our viewership already has increased since we've been in this season. We've seen greater number of persons get saved and join the church since we've been in COVID than when we were actually meeting in the building. God is doing something supernatural and amazing, and we want to move where God is moving. And so again, all that you do in terms of paying your tithe, sowing your offering, supporting Kingdom Care, supporting Kingdom Builders, I pray that you can see the fruit of your labor. And I want to just thank you for partnering with us in this endeavor. I'm going to pray now and ask that God will continue to bless us and prosper us and sustain us through this season. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we give you glory and we give you praise for your goodness and for your mercy toward us. God, we pray for those who find themselves in financial difficulty because of no fault of their own. God, we pray that you might provide for them resources, that you might sustain them. And even God, we believe you to open up a greater opportunity than they experienced before. And so God, we pray that we will continue as a church to support our brothers and sisters, both in the congregation and in this community. We thank you, God, for your provision for those who have not been affected. And God, we want to demonstrate our gratitude for you keeping us the way we've been kept by continuing to be faithful in supporting and sowing into your ministry. And so God, I pray that you'll bless both gift giver and the kingdom of God to which we are giving. We thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, y'all, it's Mother's Day. I pray that you've gotten a card or that you put together some kind of electronic means of celebration. At the end of the day, we're going to celebrate our mothers. We're going to celebrate the Lord. We're going to celebrate that God is still on the throne. He still has all power in his hand. Come on, y'all. Let's have church.
Join the Kingdom Cares movement. Opportunities to fulfill one of Kingdom Fellowship's core values, to go through outreach, evangelism, and missions, are more valuable now than ever. Over the past 5 weeks, we have served over 1,300 families with free groceries, provided approximately $5,000 in financial assistance to our members, and invested over $10,000 with our global partner, Zion AME Church Feeding Program, as well as supported local churches. If you'd like to join the movement to help serve, you can donate financially or give food items. items. You can also sign up for food sorting, packing, distribution, and delivery. Get all the details on our website. Get more details about the Kingdom Care Food Outreach on our website at kingdom.global. Stay connected to Kingdom Fellowship. Text the word Zoom to stay connected with the ministry. There are various online classes, meetings, and sessions available online through the Zoom platform. Just text the word Zoom to 313131. Also, Kingdom Fellowship needs your help to advance the gospel of Jesus Christ locally, nationally, and globally. Become a part of our Kingdom Takeover team by texting the word Takeover to 313131. Anytime we post anything online, you do the same and post on all of your social media. Life gets busy. School, work, ministry. At times it can be hard to develop and build relationships. And now, more than ever, under our current shutdown, it can be very difficult to stay connected to others. Life Groups is an opportunity to connect with other believers with common interests. The new session for Life Groups is coming up soon. Meetings will be conducted online and by phone. Get more information and stay connected on our website at kingdom.global. Life is better together.
Thank you, Jesus. We put our trust in you. The only way out. Let's lift it again. You are my refuge.
You are my refuge.
In you I'll trust.
In you I'll trust.
You are my fortress. Got me some angels.
They're
all around. So I will not fear. Hallelujah. I love this chorus. Cause when I call.
I got angels,
they're all around me.
So.
I'm encouraged, I will not. I will not fear. Listen, I want you to sing it right there where you are. Sing it. When I call. Right in the midst of my trouble,
in time,
I know you will.
When I call,
you will answer.
Ready minds, hearts, and spirits to receive that which you want to say to your church. Be glorified and we'll praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I'm ready to continue the series of sermons that we've been sharing for the last several weeks under the general heading, Now What? Turn in your Bible to Jeremiah, the 32nd chapter, beginning reading in the first verse. Jeremiah, the 32nd chapter, beginning reading in the first verse there. These words are recorded. This is the word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord in the 10th year of Zedekiah, king of Judah, which was the 18th year of Nebuchadnezzar. The army of the king of Babylon was then besieging Jerusalem, and Jeremiah the prophet was confined in the courtyard of the guard in the royal palace of Judah. Now Zedekiah, king of Judah, had imprisoned him there, saying, "Why do you prophesy as you do? You say, 'This is what the Lord says, I am about to hand this city over to the king of Babylon, and he will capture it.' Zedekiah, king of Judah, will not escape out of the hands of the Babylonians, but will certainly be handed over to the king of Babylon, and he will speak with him face to face and see him with his own eyes. He will take Zedekiah to Babylon, where he will remain until I deal with him, declares the Lord. If you fight against the Babylonians, you will not succeed." Jeremiah said, "The word of the Lord came to me. Hanamel, son of Shulam, your uncle, is going to come to you and say, 'Buy my field at Anathoth, because as nearest relative, it is your right and duty to buy it.'" Brothers and sisters, I want to commend to you the entirety of that passage, but because of the limitations of our time, I want to stop right there and tag this text, a buyer's market. A buyer's market. Amen. My brothers and my sisters, I've learned that in life, we either change
so that we can face the facts, or we change the facts so that we do not have to change. That is to say, one should never underestimate the muscle memory of the human psyche, the ability to look past facts and figures, science and statistics, experience and expertise should never be underestimated. The cold, hard facts that we must become, that we must come to grips with on a daily basis, have been shown to have life and death consequences. Consider, if you will, how we've seen this play out just over the last couple months at the global level. How early adopters in countries and in states and in individual towns and in homes, those who were willing to follow the advice of the experts of the World Health Organization, of the CDC, who donned protective gear and who practiced social distancing, those persons, by and large, were able to flatten the curve and to stave off a virus for whom no human on earth has its own antibodies. But at the same time, those who were late adopters, those who refused to accept the facts, those that tried to change the facts rather than changing their behavior, many of them unfortunately succumbed to the virus, all because they were unwilling, or even in some cases unable, to see the facts for what they were. My brothers and my sisters, I want to suggest to us that as blood-bought, twice-born believers, we must never be ruled by fear, but we must be informed by facts, but ultimately we must be inspired by faith. Listen, my faith relationship enables and emboldens me to look squarely into the face of horrifying facts and realities and move forward anyway. Did you hear what I just said? Faith was not given to us by God as a means to escape a difficult reality so that we can enter some kind of fantasy world, but rather faith is given to me by God as an act of His grace so that I might look soberly and somberly and squarely and clearly into the face of dark and difficult circumstances and declare that I believe that I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. To be a blood-bought, twice-born believer does not mean I live in denial, but rather to be a believer means I can face whatever facts life can throw in my direction and recognize that God has given me a relationship with Him that gives me to know that I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. But be clear, my brothers and sisters, the inheritance of being a kingdom believer means that you are equipped with the ability to be able to handle whatever it is life throws in your direction. Think about it. The Bible does not promise that we will not have to face the terror by day, the arrow by night, or the terror by day. The Bible promises that we don't have to fear the arrow by day or the terror by night. The Bible does not declare that because I was young and now I'm old, I've never seen the righteous forsaken nor their seed begging bread. The Bible doesn't say I'm never going to have to deal with difficulty. I'm not going to have to deal with unemployment. I'm not going to have to deal with sickness. What it says is I was young, now I'm old, but in all those circumstances, I was never what? Forsaken. My brothers and sisters, all I'm trying to suggest to us is that as we look into the difficult days in which we're living right now, we need to recognize that faith allows you to face the facts and gives you strength to deal with the facts. But hope is not a plan and denial is not a strategy. Let me call a witness to the stand and ask Jesus to testify, because when you look at Jesus's life and ministry, you'll discover that he was always able to soberly look at the circumstances he was dealing with. Jesus was clear about the fact that there was going to be one of his disciples who would betray him. He was clear about the fact that all of his disciples would desert him. He was clear about the fact that one day the city of Jerusalem would fall and the temple would fall along with it. He was clear about the fact, even on the night before he was crucified, that this was his lot in life. And even though it was not his desire, he was willing to submit to the will of God for his life, praying, "Father, not my will, but thy will be done." All I'm simply trying to say to you is that as we try to navigate through this now what season, what's going to happen next? Well, what happens if they never come up with a vaccine? What happens if we go from recession to depression? What happens if somebody in my home contracts the virus? What happens if I should lose a loved one? I come to tell you that my faith allows me to deal with every reality that life can hand my way. Not that I have the power on my own, but God will give me that which I need when I need it. All I'm simply trying to suggest to you is that you got to face it if God is going to fix it. That courage is not what I do because I'm not scared. Courage is what I do even when I'm scared. And if you want to understand this concept, I would direct your attention to this little sliver of scripture we read here in Jeremiah, the 32nd chapter, wherein we see the Babylonian army is once again on the attack. At the time of our text, the Babylonian army already has made great progress and now literally has siege ramps mounted against the walls of Jerusalem. The Bible says that the Jewish archers and the soldiers' blood now runs through the streets of Jerusalem. And at this particularly difficult, this crisis time in the life and history of Judah, the Bible says that God does something unexpected. God puts an unusual word in the mouth of his prophet Jeremiah. The Bible says that God tells Jeremiah to declare to all who will listen that Babylon is going to defeat Judah. And not only is Babylon going to win, but he also declares that the king of Judah, King Zedekiah, is going to be captured, taken captive, and taken to stand before King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon. And if that was not enough, then God tells Jeremiah to declare, "And Judah, if you try to resist the Babylonians, you shall be defeated." But brothers and sisters, you can only imagine how unpopular this word made him with the people who were fighting for his lives. But imagine, if you will, how unpopular this word made him with King Zedekiah himself. And maybe that's the reason why King Zedekiah had Jeremiah imprisoned in his royal palace in Judah. The Bible says that Jeremiah finds himself quarantined. He finds himself restricted. He finds himself unable to move. His essential business of prophesying has caused him to be quartered and confined in this place. But can I just stop right here and put a little preaching right there? Because what hits me is that even though King Zedekiah is doing his worst to Jeremiah, it's still working out for Jeremiah's good. Let me see if I can show it to you. I just told you that Jeremiah is being kept where? In the king's palace, which means he still is in the most secure place in the kingdom, that even though he's a prisoner in the king's palace, whatever food he eats is still being made in the same kitchen from where the king gets his own food. What's your point, preacher? My point simply is this, that I don't know what's been going on in the particularity of the specificity of your life since you've been in quarantine. I don't know what you've lost, and I don't know what you've dealt with, but this much I know: God somehow has supernaturally been able to keep you despite what's going on and throughout our nation and throughout our world. God has a supernatural habit of putting a protective hedge around his people. God has a way of sustaining you and strengthening you and covering you and keeping you. Somebody right now ought to give out an audible hallelujah. Somebody listening to me right now and knows that I'm right ought to give an enthusiastic thank you, Jesus, says, if you know for sure that even through this season, you've seen the hand of God cover you and keep you even while you've been in quarantine. Oh my goodness. The Bible says that there he is in prison. And the Bible says that while he is there in prison, something interesting happens. He's in prison, first of all, because Zedekiah does not like the word, watch this, that God has put in the mouth of Jeremiah. In other words, he's in trouble because the one who is in senior leadership does not like the news that Jeremiah is reporting, that rather than facing the facts of the situation, rather than realizing that they can't win, rather than realizing that Jerusalem already is under authority of the Babylonians, this individual is so narcissistic. This individual is so insecure. This individual is so off that he would rather silence those who speak the truth. By the way, anybody seen Dr. Fauci lately? Anybody seen Attorney General Jerome lately? Anybody seen Rex Tillerson lately? Anybody seen John Kelly lately? It just seems to me interesting that every time somebody stands up and speaks the truth, that this individual tries to get rid of them, tries to banish them because he can't handle the truth, because the truth indicts his leadership and indicts his time in office. All I'm trying to show you is that Zedekiah has a problem with Jeremiah because Jeremiah keeps on speaking the truth about the situation. And can I tell somebody right along here that at some point, my brothers and sisters, throughout this season, you and I have got to distinguish ourselves from those who were not able to face difficult facts. Because as Dr. King said many decades ago, we still have some rough days ahead. We still have to have the ability to face facts and make spiritually led decisions. We've got to get to the point we're willing to have courageous conversations, even with the people who live in our own homes. We got to tell somebody, and listen, I know that's your boy, I know that's your girl, but I don't know where they've been. I don't know if they're asymptomatic, and so they're going to have to stay outside. I know I'm ruining the relationship, but listen, I got to make some decisions that are in the best interest of our people. Now that things are starting to be opened up here in Maryland, somebody's going to have to make some courageous decisions. Like, I know I can't protect myself 100%, but I've got more to worry about than just my health. I've also got to worry about the health of our household. And so I'm going to do everything I can protect myself to do, but I may have to go back to work so that I can keep this thing afloat. I'm not trying to give you advice. I'm trying to suggest to you that it is only when you trust God that you're able to see clearly his way forward. And your way may not be somebody else's way, but that's why you got to know God's voice for yourself, for he declared, my sheep know my voice, and another they will not listen to. Are you hearing what I'm saying today? The Bible says that Zedekiah had a problem with Jeremiah because Jeremiah would not stop speaking the truth. Here it is. The Bible says Jeremiah is in prison. And here's the part I like. While he's in prison, the Bible says he gets a visitor, and God gave him advance notice of what the visitor was going to say. God told him, listen, your cousin is coming down to see about you. His name is Hanimal. And Hanimal is going to offer you the opportunity to buy some land in Anathoth. Now, why is that so significant? It's because his cousin was coming to give him the right to redeem or to purchase the land because he himself could no longer afford it. The law said that in order to keep the property within the family, it was always the right of the family members to purchase or to redeem the property before it went out for auction in the public market. What's interesting to me about that is that the first thing that God does in order to get Jeremiah ready for what he's got to do is he tells him before it happens so that when he sees when it happens, he knows it's happening from God. I feel like preaching right along here. Now, what he told Jeremiah to do, he needed to give him advance instruction on, because what he was is telling him to do doesn't make any sense. Think about it. Jeremiah is in jail. And at any given point, the unstable leader of the nation can have him taken out. And so this don't seem like the time to be investing in real estate. But let me push it a little bit further. Because the Bible says that Anathoth, according to historians, was actually already captured by the Babylonians by the time the property came to him to sell. So now I got two good reasons why he shouldn't buy. First of all, he's on lockdown. Secondarily, he can't even get to the property, even if he was free, because the Babylonians are already in control of it. But here's the part I need you to understand. In order to be a kingdom believer, every now and then you've got to move opposite of conventional wisdom. I told you a couple weeks ago about how God told Noah to build a big boat in the middle of a desert. And every now and then, the way that the children of God distinguish ourselves is that we don't act like everybody else. We don't talk like everybody else. And we don't live like everybody else. While the rest of the world is panicking, while the rest of the world is self-medicating, while the rest of the world is spiraling down, this is the hour and now is the time for the people of God to stand and to show what being the benefit of being a believer is all about. That I can be in trouble, but I don't have to be troubled. That I can be going through a mess, but I don't have to be a mess because God has given me a peace. Oh my goodness, that surpasses all understanding. God told Jeremiah, your cousin Hammond was coming to see you and he's about to make you an offer. And so imagine now Jeremiah's surprise when the unthinkable happens and Hannibal walks into a jail cell and says just what God said he was going to say. We call that in church confirmation. Can I give you a theological definition of confirmation? Confirmation is what I call a spiritual snack. You know what a snack is. It's a little stuff you eat in between the major meal. It's not enough to get you full. It's not enough to nourish you. It's just enough to hold you over until the main meal is ready. Well, can I tell you, my brothers and sisters, every now and then, God will give you some confirmation. Every now and then, God will give you some spiritual snacks. Every now and then, God will show you small glimpses of his glory, glimpses of his power, glimpses of his grace in your life to let you know you ain't out here on your own. You're not trying to make it by yourself, but there's a God who's still on your side and is still causing all things to work together for your good. Who am I preaching to in your family room right now? Is there anybody listening to me that can testify that throughout this season you've seen God move in major and also in minor ways? You've seen God gives you signs that he's yet working on your behalf, and before it's all over, he's going to cause things to switch in your direction. The Bible says that Hannibal came to Jeremiah and he said, listen, I need you to buy this property. And here's the part I like. The Bible says, and Jeremiah bought it for some silver. Y'all missed a good shot. I'm going to try it again. He offered him the ability to buy the property, and Jeremiah didn't have to go searching for a payday loan. Jeremiah didn't have to put nothing in hawk in order to get the money to buy the property. That even though he was in quarantine, he was in financial position to take advantage of the real estate opportunity that had been presented him. I hope, I pray that during this quarantine season, you've seen some rise in your personal financial situation. I pray that you've not been driving as much, and so you've not had to spend as much on gas. I pray you've not been going out to eat as much and shop as much and going to the concerts as much. So I pray that like Jeremiah during this quarantine season, you're learning how to be a better steward over the resources that God has given you. Shucks, because if you ain't saving no money on lockdown right now, then I don't know what you're going to do when we get up out of here. I'm trying to tell you, my brothers and sisters, that in order to be sober-minded, you got to face the facts that maybe some of the ways you were managing your resources were not in your best interest. interest nor pleasing to God. And through this season, one of the things you ought to make up in your mind is that I refuse to come out as broke as I went in. I feel like getting happy right along here. Here it is. The Bible says that Jeremiah was able to buy the land. Now, can I take it to closing real quick? Because back in the day, they didn't have closing attorneys, but here's how it worked. They would take two deeds and they would fill them out and sign them. And then they would take one of the deeds up and seal it. And after they sealed it, they would put both deeds in a jar and they would close the jar. Why? Because it was an indication that anytime these are needed, this shows who the property belongs to. It shows who the proper owner is. And we're going to put it in a jar for safekeeping. We're going to put it in a jar to preserve it. We're going to put it in the jar so the deeds don't wither, so the deeds don't decay, so the deeds don't go away, so that who owns it will always be clear. I feel like shouting right along now because I've come to tell you to be a believer, to be born again, to be a Christian, to be a part of the kingdom of God means that you've got a deed. You're part of a covenant, that God makes you a promise, that he puts his ownership seal on your life, that you are no longer your own, but you were bought with a price. I'm trying to tell somebody that Jeremiah signed the deed and then he put both deeds in the jar and they sealed the jar up. Why? Because he knows it's going to be a long time before he can go and claim his property. And if you're asking why in the world would he buy some property in the middle of the situation, God speaks in verse 15 and he says, because one day houses and fields and vineyards will again be bought in this land. I gotta go, y'all, but I come to tell somebody, it doesn't matter how bad it is, it doesn't matter how dark it gets, the God I serve makes me a promise that he knows the plans that he has for me, plans for my welfare, not for my harm, to give me a future and a hope. I speak a word of life to every individual listening to me right now. I speak a word of hope, that your hope can't be in the government, your hope can't be in your own ability, but put your hope in Jesus, the God of your salvation, and he will lead you forward. He will lead you on a level path. He will lead you in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. I gotta go. I didn't mean to push it this far, but when I think of the promises of God, I recognize that he sealed them and he's put them in a jar and they're kept for my good, in order to build land, in order to build houses, in order to plant vineyards, in order to plant fields. That means I'm going to have some patience. Maybe the reason you're still frustrated and driving yourself crazy is because you've yet to practice the spiritual discipline of patience. You got to learn you can't hurry God. You just have to wait. But I come to tell you, there's a blessing in the waiting. For though the fig tree may not blossom, nor fruit be on the vines, though the labor of the olive may fail, and the fields yield no food, though the flock may be cut off from the fold, and there be no herds in the stall, somebody shout, yet, I will rejoice in the Lord. I will joy in the God of my salvation. The Lord God is my strength, and he will make me like the deer's feet. I come to tell you, wait on the Lord and be of good courage, and he will strengthen your heart. Wait, I say, upon the Lord, for the vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end it shall speak and shall not lie. Though it tarry, wait for it, because it will surely touch yourself and say, surely it's gonna come to pass. It's a buyer's market, for the grass withers and the flowers fade, but the word of the Lord shall stand forever. For even youths shall be weary, and young men shall utterly fail, but they that wait upon the Lord They shall renew their strength. They shall mount up on wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. So long, y'all. I'll see you next week. But I come to declare in the name of Jesus, it's a buyer's market. What does that mean? That means when everything's gotten so bad, when prices have come down so far, when everybody else has run out of resources, that's the time for you to step in and take advantage of the opportunity that's waiting for you. Is there anybody watching me right now that understands in your spirit, I can't put my finger on it, I can't find it on the internet, but something on the inside is telling me that everything is gonna be all right. Say yeah, say yeah. The Holy Ghost done told me that everything. Say yeah, say yeah, say yeah. It's a buyer's market. Get your mind right. Get your money right. Get your marriage right. Get your family right. Get your fitness right. Because when I come back, I'm coming back better than I was before. For the glory of the latter house shall be greater than the glory of the former house. Do you believe it? Say yeah. Say yeah. Yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah to God. It's a buyer's market. Right now, I want to pray for you. I want to pray God's strength, his keeping all power to be made manifest in your life. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for my brother, my sister right now, who has been living in fear because of the facts. God, I pray that you might grant them a new measure of faith. Faith that defeats negative facts. In the name of Jesus, I pray, my brother, my sister, to know that you are yet preparing and preserving your promise and the deed to their blessing. Now, God, we claim, while the siege ramps are still mounted on the wall, we're going to build houses again. We're going to plant fields and vineyards again. And we're going to see your hand at work in mighty and miraculous ways in our lives. It's in Jesus' name we want to say thank you. All God's children said amen. My brothers, my sisters, don't turn off yet. This is the moment that God has been trying to get you to. He's trying to get you to the point where you're once and for all surrender yourself to him. You've been trying to live under your own power long enough. You've been trying to figure it out on your own, but you can't be yourself and your God at the same time. You be you and let God be God in your life. If you're watching me right now, but you don't know the Lord Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, if you're unsaved or unsure about what it means to be saved, if you've never accepted him in your heart, never allowed him to take up ownership or lordship of your life, I have good news. Today is the day of salvation. He wants to save your soul right now. All you got to do, we're going to make it real easy. Just click on the little tab on the screen, and one of our prayer partners is waiting to reach out to you. Just put your name and your number in the form. They're going to call you within a matter of minutes, show you in the Word of God what it means to be saved, pray with you the prayer of salvation, and you'll know that your name has been written on God's deed. If you're unsaved, this is your time. It's time to be saved. Somebody else, you're watching me, but you don't have a church home where you're growing. You're not connected. You're watching in isolation. You don't have a family of faith to call your own. If you don't honestly have a church home where you're growing in God, then I would love to be your pastor. We would love to be your church. We don't want to see you by yourself. The Bible says, forsake not the assembling of yourselves together. That means you got to be a part of the body of Christ. So if you're without a church home, we would love to be your church. Just click on that banner. Somebody's going to reach out to you name by name. And all you got to do is fill out that information. They'll be in touch with you in just a couple minutes. Finally, if you're falling off and you need to rededicate your life, it's okay. God is married to the backslider. He's been just waiting for you to come back to him. He's not even going to hold it against you. He's not like people. He won't hold it over your head. He just wants to welcome you back and strengthen you and restore you in the right relationship. Come on, click that tab and tell that person, I need to rededicate my life. Come on, there's nothing better. There's nothing better. Hallelujah. Than knowing Jesus. Come on, my brother. Come on, my sister.
He will pick you up and turn your life around.
Hallelujah. You ought to know him.
You ought to know him.
Come on, get to know him.
Get to know him.
Right now.
Right now.
Today.
Today.
Just come. Come on, my brother. Come on, my sister. Make the decision that makes all the difference in your life. Come on, just click that button and watch that your life will be different because you made a step of faith. Hallelujah. Come on, you can do it. It's not too late and it's not too bad. God can turn it around. God can turn you around. But you got to allow him to come in and set you free. Listen, let me just say this very quickly. All I know is life is better together. It's better with God than out here on your own. It's better with a church home on your side than trying to navigate life by yourself. And so if you're feeling lonely, maybe it's because you don't have the spiritual resource and connection that God has given you as a kingdom believer. If you need to rededicate your life, I just want to give you one more chance to say yes. You don't know if it's your last chance, but you ought to take advantage of it while you still have time. I'm going to ask the White Family Singers to feel like the Sound of Music. Amen. Y'all, come on and minister that song one more time. And we're going to just give you one more chance. Come on.
Come on, come on, come on.
Come on, come on, come on.
Come on, come on.
Right now.
Right now, today.
Come on, one more time. We're waiting. God's waiting.
Come on,
come on. God bless you, my brothers and sisters. We certainly thank God for this time together. And I want to encourage you to spend the rest of the day with God. To keep all your devices on spiritual resources for the rest of the day and give the day fully, wholly to God. Make this sanctify this day, consecrated unto the Lord by singing spiritual songs, by YouTubing other messages, and pour into yourself something that will allow you to face the facts that are waiting for you on tomorrow. Receive now the benedictions, grace, peace, and mercy from God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Spirit, rest, rule, and abide now with these your people, both now and forevermore. Give God said amen.
Amen.
Come on, say it again.
Amen.
Say it one more time. God bless you as you go. Kingdom.
Loving you is like food to my soul.
Loving you is like food to my soul. Oh. Food to my soul. Yes, you are.
Happy Mother's Day, Mom.
We love you.
Happy Mother's Day, we love you.
Mommy, we love you. Happy Mother's Day.
We love you, Mom. Happy Mother's Day.
Cause I am super.
Happy Mother's Day. I love you, Mom.
Happy Mother's Day, Mom. We love you.
Happy Mother's Day, Mom. Thank you for bringing me into this world and caring about me for 15 years, even though I might be crazy.
Happy Mother's Day, Mom. Thank you for loving me every day and always being there when I needed you.
Happy Mother's Day to the best mom ever. I love you.
Happy Mother's Day, Mom. Love you.
Happy Mother's Day, baby. You're the best.
This right here goes out to the most respected, the most loved, the most looked up to mom in the world as your first, your favorite. I just want to wish you a happy Mother's Day.
Happy Mother's Day, Mom.
Happy Mother's Day, Grandma.
Happy Mother's Day, Mom. Love you.
Happy Mother's Day. I love you, Mom.
Happy Mother's Day.